All right. We are going to get started. My name is Andrew Liptak. I am the events coordinator for Bear Pond Books, and would like to welcome you to tonight's event. Before we get started, I just wanted to make a couple announcements of some upcoming events that we have for the rest of the month for the good of the order. So we have tonight's event with Neil Shepard, Stephen Kramer, and Karen Gottschall.
Close enough.
Okay. Because it's National Poetry Month, we have a couple of other poetry events coming up. On April 26th, we have the 19th Annual Open Poetry Night. On April 30th, it is Independent Bookstore Day, where we will also be celebrating Veruca's birthday. There'll be a whole bunch of giveaways, some cake, other things like that. So come on by. Come celebrate your local store. And on the 3rd of May, we have After the Haiku of Yossa Bosin with David Budbill. All of our events during the week are at 7 p.m. The Independent Bookstore Day is all day long. And that's what we have coming up in the next couple of weeks. We hope to see you soon. So tonight's event is the Night of Poetry with Neil Shepard, Stephen Kramer, and Karen Gottschall. Neil Shepard is an American poet, essayist, professor of creative writing, and literary magazine editor. He has his BA from the University of Vermont, MFA from Colorado State University, and a PhD from Ohio State University. Ohio University. His latest book is...
Do we have a copy?
Oh. Vermont Exit Ramps. There it is. Right here.
Oh, right under my nose.
It's rising up over your head.
Actually, no, give me yours real quick so I can get the titles right. They'll be reading from their event. Their books are here. So his latest book is Vermont Exit Ramps 2.
Which presupposes a one.
Yes, we also have the first. We also have the first one as well, which she is modeling right now. Next up, we have Stephen Kramer, whose first book of poems, Shiva's Drum, was selected for the National Poetry Series and was published by the University of Illinois Press. From the Hip, which follows the history of hip hop in a series of 56 sonnets, came out in 2014 from Windridge Press. And his latest book is Bone Magic, which we have several copies of, which you graciously brought in.
It's bone music.
Oh.
It's okay.
I misread that, sorry. Bone Music, sorry, not Bone Magic.
Yeah.
Bone Magic's kind of cool, though. It's a sequel.
The next one.
Sequel, yeah.
And Karen Gottschall is a poet and fiction writer who teaches poetry writing at Middlebury College. She also directs the New England Young Writers Conference at Breadloaf. She received her BA with an emphasis in creative writing from Sarah Lawrence College and an MFA in writing from Vermont College. And her latest book is The River Won't Hold You, which won the Ohio State University Press and Journal Wheeler Prize and is now available. So take it away.
Okay.
I'll give these back to you. And I suppose I should give you this
you
one
as well.
You should
give him a copy of the book because it says all smart things I could not possibly say now.
Hi, everybody. Thanks for coming out. And it's a really great lineup. These two other poets are fabulous. I'll try to keep up. And I'm going to read just from the new book, the newest of the new books. There were two books published in 2015. The other is for sale called Hominid Up. And that one is by an Irish press called Salmon Poetry Press. And this one is by a Vermont press called Green Writers Press out of Brattleboro. And it's fitting that that press published Vermont Exit Ramps 2, which is a big book with a lot of photographs by this wonderful photographer friend of mine who has photos in the Vermont Life and Vermont Magazine. We've known each other since college, and he drove up and down the highways with me and took the photographs, and I wrote the poems. And only occasionally had to outrun the police who were after us as we were at these ramps. So I'm going to read five poems, and I'll start with the title poem. This one is more of the overview. It's called Vermont Exits. Who will claim the kingdom of exit ramps and clover leaves on the hillsides of I-89? These realms of birch and pine, rippling and mountain wind on a spring day, domains of quiet forgetfulness, places ravaged and recovered. These little domains of bedstraw and clover, harboring deer and bear who stare at cars grinding past. A driver's hands crossed around the curve, a driver's mind attuned to the bend and merge of traffic motoring down hillsides to the towns. Perhaps a deer lifts its head from grazing, its jaw grinding sideways, its ears alive to the downshift of gears or simple wind along the ridgeline, beech leaves scratching over moss and duff. You might slow or stop here for a quick piss or a picnic of wood sorrel and ribgrass, young dandelion and fiddlehead. Or you might imagine a small cabin of clay and wattles made, claiming this place no one claims. The heavy machinery having rattled past and gouged a pasture elsewhere. And so that one is an overview, but a lot of these are specific to a particular exit ramp, and they sort of combine personal memory of a place with history, and as well as adding all kinds of other things, snippets of literary texts, historical pamphlets, Chinese fortune cookie fortunes that I picked up at various restaurants along the way, anagrams that have been scrambled, like you feed Montpelier into an anagram scrambler and you ask for 2 and 3 word permutations and you get something like triple omen, which is or politer men or something like that. Okay, so I'm going to read, actually, since we're in Montpelier, I'll read the Montpelier exit and you will hear a little bit of it. And it mixes fact, historical fact, with a lot of fiction. Here we go. I-89, exit 8, Montpelier, Route 2, 302, May 18th, 1:45 p.m., hazy, sun, and clouds. That's the title. Capital exit ahead, Gold Dome. Every capital mind is a mind in progress, for progress, until it's not. Pet project for the interstate, mile rent ops. For new billboards, the band be damned. We need to fatten our calves and our coffers. Many a false step is made by standing still. Well, let's hope politer men prevail. Today, the Winooski swells with spring runoff, glinting below as you slow. Bridge work, please merge early. Merge toward Montpelier, where in the red is ugly, in the black, beautiful. Merge toward a name that's contraction and contradiction, Montpelier, Montpelier. Shorn hill is what it means. Really, it's a glacial bowl, half empty, half full, depending on the plumbing of the waterworks on Dog River Road to keep the affluent from the effluent. That's where farm runoff meets town runoff. That's where suburbs end. On that road, a tractor wobbles along, hauling a fertilizer spreader, an enormous mutt perched on the tailgate. At the last stop sign of the last suburban curb cut, it lifts a leg into the pea-lit morn. Relieved. Toward what piece of backwoods are they retreating? Montpelier lost its last clothespin store in 2007. The last in America before it burned. Today's primary business is fire and life insurance and government. Senators serve best who bring home the bacon, the dairy subsidy, the maple syrup tariff. To reach them, follow the guardrails off the ramp, like centurions off some processional, formal columns and great walls of granite guiding you down. No place to stop and consult the map before the force of the long curve turns the steering wheel in your hands, the build-up, bank, pressure, triple omen. And suddenly, you're straightening out, gliding into the capital with a swelled river, a glistering dome, a library with a copy of the frieze from the Parthenon, and signs painted all over town. Keep the billboard ban. Vote the Progressive Party. They really do have a copy of the Parthenon, the frieze of the Parthenon, don't they, here? at the library. Exit 6, South Barry. There's a sign as you come in, granite quarries, next right. Ravens loop the high air above this exit, one of the wild settlements in Vermont. Don't kill it with a poem. Never mind. No one reads except the words in chisel's stone for a burst hero. A pile of birch length stacked at the end of the glen as if someone's home. Where can I pull off legally? Nowhere. 6 miles, the descent to the valley, and up the other side, the pyramid mountain in the eastern distance. Out there, brown dust and the famous depths of Barry quarries. Granite, drilled, dynamited, dragged away. Clank, belch, and roar of steam shovel, bucket loader, dump truck. He who throws dirt is losing ground. Here, a hilltop swamp, balsam fir and cattail, wetlands with red wings wheeze, swamp sparrows sewing needle call. Under the overpass, 3 massive cement pillars, culverts with white PVC pipes to divert runoff. Beside it, sumac, yellow birch, yellow sign saying merge. A flatbed goes by, hauling an old stagecoach. What's my time zone? In 1810, the basic work was sawmill, grist mill. Everyone poor, everything moved with a wooden wagon. 1812, the first granite carved from quarry hauled off with a wooden wagon. Stone soup, starvation. A full century passed before richness came with the railroad, and with it a means of moving granite on a grand scale. Words chiseled in cemetery stones from Barry to wherever death required it. He who throws dirt is losing ground to Barry, and they increased. It's death or us. Did I say that? And they increase. It's breath or us is how it should be. Breath or us spelled in an anagram is Barry. South Barry. I'm going to read 2 more, and they're sort of longish pieces. And one, the first one is called Romaine Tenney. And Romaine Tenney was a real character, a farmer who lived earlier in the 20th century. And I read about him in Yankee Magazine, and then I did more research, and I extruded it through the poetic imagination, came out with this poem.
Question.
Yes.
Is this the one where the exit goes through his farm?
This is the one where the exit actually goes right through Romaine Tenney, the
I
poor man.
I love this poem so much. Sorry.
It must mean it's a good poem. Thanks.
So good. Okay.
Romaine Tenney. Hello, Blackfly. Thanks for the welcome. Now I know what Romaine Tenney cursed and loved here on Tenney Hill Road. The sting inside blossoming, the black bother at the center of the eye bent on spring beauty. Tenney knew what was coming, and it came. The interstate that brought the commerce in, and with it the quick buck with its quick made and quick fading values. It didn't value Tenney's enterprise on a hill farm that was collapsing around him. He lived in the mudroom L of his old family home, with gingerbread eaves and wraparound porches sagging, lawns and meadows stretching in all directions. In the mudroom, he was closer to his animals, 30 milking cows, 20 laying hens, 2 teams of workhorses, some sows, some goats, and 4 herding dogs. He lived for them and for himself as days folded into days, and he daily tilled the soil or tinkered with machines that made the farm hum. He ate simple, oatmeal, biscuits, beans. He drank switchel or spring water. He watched over his fields. He watched the workers up valley gouge the land to make the interstate. He studied a document, eminent domain. He said no to the 10,000 they offered. No to the 13,000 simoleons they said were his last chance. He said, no value you can place on this place that birthed me and gave me my daily bread, my milk and eggs, my purpose on earth. I ain't leaving. You'll have to throw me off. And that's how the sheriff found him when he came with his men on a Friday in September to empty the house and the barns. Tenney was gentle as always, sadly smiling, eyes pooled blue as he watched the dismantling of whatever it was to have an estate seized by the state. Yes, Tenney knew it was coming, and it came. The highway, that is, whizzing by beyond the park and ride where I stand today, shaded by a Tenney maple, says the plaque, rooted roughly in the middle of his farm, rooted 200 years ago when his grandkin settled in. Tenney might have winced at Wally's Road extending from the park and ride with a sign, private property, no entrance. Tenney tried that once, private property. Little good it did with government bent on progress. It was progress and plain misfortune when a surveyor with a gouging road crew at the end of a long day laying road and right before sunset saw sun glint off the weather vane on Tenney's barn as he squinted down valley for the way forward and said, we'll sight the road there, straight through the middle of that man's farm. Yes, this must have been a sweet piece of land back then. Now it's a four lane with a median. Cars going south would have driven straight through his cow barn. Northbound traffic would have run him over in his iron bed. Now the place is nothing, or the saddest spot in Vermont, where a man lived 60 years before he burned it up, burned it down. He loved it all, the animals, the husbandry. Never married, he wedded the fields and the woodlots. The land was his, and he was the land's, and time had nothing and everything to do with it. Time in which generations could pass without the least change to road or rail bed. Time to talk across a roadway or lawn to kith and kin or tourists from the cities to the south who sought a real Vermonter, lanky, bearded, wry, with a gentle light in his eyes, a light content with a self-made life, and only himself to praise or blame for a problem or a cure. In 1964, the highway came straight through his home. The sheriff came to move him off the farm. And sometime after midnight in his 64th year, Tenney set loose his animals, set the farm on fire, trudged back to his bed, and closed the door on Autumn, bolted it, spiked it shut, loaded his shotgun and triggered it as the house smoked and blazed. Self-immolation was his only protest. The hillside burned for a night and a day. Afterwards, the road crew worked in a stupor, the surveyor drank, and the state never tendered a note of condolence to his next of kin, never mind an apology. They just progressed. And there's a postscript by his sister, Rosemary Tenney, who says, he was born there. He loved the land. He loved farming. He loved, I'm talking truly loved. He worked hard every day, 7 days a week, and it was all out of love, not out of duty or commitment or need. It was the love of the land. That's all it was, says Rosemary Tenney, who herself apparently was a poet. Okay, and then the last poem I'll read is of I-91, Exit 14, Thetford, and it's near sunset. And here's what happens when sunlit vistas on Vermont highways interact with a poetic imagination. And there are two women who make an appearance, a former lover and Grace Paley. And Grace Paley, as you know, is one of was at one point the Vermont State Poet. And she's one of the great short story writers in America, in the world, in fact. and she had a second home in Thetford. Lit vistas on the highway between Norwich and Thetford. Plenty of room for cumulus glow and mind-lit memory to play this life against another. Nature's first gold in the trees, chartreuse pastures, dandelions zoned liminal against marsh marigold. Our car climbs toward hillsides flooded with sun. Her hair was gold, her gold wire rims, her gold fillings glinting in a laughing mouth. Dilapidated cabin off a fourth-class road, a leaf-covered path, a piano out of tune in one room, a sagging double bed in the other. But what gold tones it hummed in the Thetford heat. North of White River, exits expand in leisurely cloverleafs. More land, more leisure. For instance, Thetford Academy's handsome holdings on nearby Thetford Hill, a small village of stately colonials edged by equestrian zones. Gentlemen farms and two boys teams on the playing field, kicking soccer balls, tossing softballs. I never played with her kids. Funny the things a marriage sheds. The boys stayed with their father, and we wandered the midnight trails to find glowworms' phosphorescence, hoot owls' call, a sudden rush of wings and a moonless night right before us. Nearby, Grace Paley made a second home, a long way from Brooklyn. I can hear her accent in the woods. I can hear the cadence of her prose. I can see her laughing eyes, her mess of white hair, her jaw always chewing something, sometimes just an idea or an injustice which the forest knew nothing of. But she knew it and brought it here, and the forest had to listen, just as she had to listen to the forest. I'm confused by vistas that let in too much light. My mind can't make sense of more than a few perspectives. I wish I could multitask like my daughter, who comes out of the shower singing a new pop song and announces she loves existentialism, finds baseball boring, has a yeast infection, and she's writing a paper on code switching among the urban Wolof. Can I even get this all into a poem? The clouds are moving fast, and Grace is gone from Thetford, from Brooklyn, from anywhere I can name. But her name is on the cover of City Lights publication number 6, just one beat book away from Ginsberg's Howl. And I imagine her lighting up the sky just now as she crosses toward her next destination. And that woman I mentioned in lines 5 through 9 is long gone from my life. I don't know if she's walking with Grace, or with her own grown kids, or with a new man. I hope she never returned to her husband. That story was over before I arrived at I-89 exit 1, or I-91 exit 14, or any of the other exits that were my entrance to a sunlit column of time through the blasted granite where we laughed together and parted finally because of time, our mismatched ages, and another flash of gold that turned my head to other opportunities. What a convenient evasion, other opportunities. Sorry about that. East Thetford is ruined by Route 5. Trucks rumble by outside the trembling houses. But further afield, on hillsides and along the lakes, the land's dearer, the habitations trimmed and ornamented. I never traveled to Thetford Center, 5 winding miles off highway. But I bet the light glows there in a town with a real town center, a village green fenced with split birch and lilacs purpling late daylight. I just bet it. And Grace, and that woman I found before the time of fireflies, when the ground was still pregnant with glowworms, are there too. That's how vistas work. That's what we imagine. Thank you.
Does Stephen get an introduction?
No, I think,
or,
I think we did the introductions, right? I'm just gonna, you know what? I just...
You gotta move it closer.
I do, I just need to, like...
Okay.
So, actually, so my friend Mike, I think, was telling me about a time he went to a concert in college, and there was a woman who was like, right?
Uh-huh.
See this here? This is my boogie space. Ain't nobody better get in my boogie space. And I think I just needed another, like, 6 inches of boogie space back here before I could, you know, do this thing. Anyway, so...
Am I in your boogie space?
No, you're No, come back, come back. So thank you to Bear Pond. Obviously, thank you to Neil and Karen. I'm so happy to be reading with you guys. I love both of these poets' work, and it's just a pleasure to be doing this with you guys. So, hey, Issa, are we going to do our thing real quick?
Hi.
Do you want to come up real quick? Come here. So this is my daughter, Issa. She's 5 years old. And Issa, how do you fix a broken jack-o'-lantern?
With a pumpkin patch.
Boom. Good job. Thank you.
All right, she nailed it.
She's ready. She's ready for this. So this is a new book. It's still, like, 2 weeks old, and I'm still, like, feeling how silky it is on my cheek. And so I'm still in this kind of enamored space with the new work here. I do have to tell you before I start reading from this about the cover image. This is a skull, or an X-ray of a skull. And the story is that in the 1950s in Russia, Russian hipsters had a difficult time getting their hands on some of the new music, right? Right? From the United States. So you couldn't get your hands on any of the budding rock and roll. Couldn't get your hands on any of like Miles Davis or Bebop. And so what they found was if they could get a copy of one record, a bootleg record, they could make a copy of it on X-rays. X-rays were just the right width and texture that they could make records on it. So this, what you see on here, is actually a record. That could play, like I said, either bebop or rock and roll or something like that. People would dumpster dive behind hospitals and just get hundreds, thousands, as many X-rays as they possibly could get so that they could make music. And I just love the idea of music being spun out of our bones, you know? I will read that poem a little bit later, but that was the gist of this... this title here. So I'm going to start with a poem called Cold Was the Ground. And it's named after the Blind Willie Johnson song that is somewhere up in space on the spacecraft Voyager, which has that gold disc with all sorts of sounds from planet Earth, just in case there are aliens out there who would like to hear what we're like and get a sense of what Earth is like. So Cold Was the Ground. A moan dragged across gravel, a guitar's metallic complaint and shimmy. These sounds rattle the zodiac. They wail to the mute eruption and flare of a collapsing star. Dark was the night, cold was the ground, by Blind Willie Johnson. 3 minutes and 15 seconds of bruised spiritual is touring the cosmos alongside the Brandenburg Concerto and Johnny Be Good on the spacecraft Voyager. The music flanked by a slew of natural sounds, surf and thunder, crickets, a kiss, a heartbeat, an oral primer to planet Earth. The world is phonic. What is matter? Blueberry, backhoe, the back of your hand, but the shards of that primeval sound when the universe detonated from the ghost of a pebble. On this journey, any one man's history is dwarfed by boundless gulf and pulsar. Voyager, long past Pluto, is 100,000 years from the next system. But here you are on Earth. And so it matters that when Johnson was 7, his stepmother, aiming for his father, cast lie into his face, the price for his father's infidelity. Blinded, he was resigned to a street corner. The dull rattle of tips pooling in a cup. A woman passing to another running catalog of bouquets. Husk of sweat at first, then salt, then almonds. Her body's continuous assertions grown hyperbolic. He could smell moods, their delicate swerves, evident as each nuance of skins pit and swell. He could smell the fur before it brushed his arm, before the woman backed away in a clatter of heels. And years later, he could smell the stench of soaked char in the ruined pit of his house. Turned away from the hospital after the fire that gutted his roof, he returned to a rain-soaked bed of newspaper and soot, and pneumonia killed him in the ashes, beneath a ceiling not of wood or plaster, but of stars. What are blues with no human to hear? What is a kiss or a heartbeat to that grand sweep of interplanetary ash, but molecules bumping molecules? Stranger, unimaginable, intergalactic pilgrim who's never even heard of a tongue. If you've found this note curled in our million-dollar can, hear the absurdity of our glory and our pain. Transmute it into we know not what. Space dust, star kindling, restore us back to sound. So it's hot. Still trying to figure out what to read and orders and things like that. I don't know. I think I'll do this. This is called Giving Blood. Just one thing you need to know. Due to complications, I had multiple transfusions at birth that ultimately saved me. I was not in good shape. And I actually had a clergy do last rites over me when I was days old, which I'm pretty sure means that I can do whatever the heck I want to, and I'm good to go. So I don't know, but that's up for debate. We can talk about that afterwards if you want to. So this is called Giving Blood. The quick pinprick opens the smallest window in my skin. The needle tapped into my arm to begin the long glide into the surrogate vein, liquid poppy coiling the tube. A curtain away, a man is absolutely delirious. At least, that's how it sounds from his protest, that he don't want the blood of, you fill in the blank, a spick, a raghead, a fag, to pollute his straight white heart. He works up a storm of curses. He's all scold and backtalk, and heads start to turn when he threatens to jet for the door. But instead, he's lost his breath. He collapses, and I hear the cot take his weight. Even from here, my arm cool with alcohol, the artery swollen, the pint siphoned off from its pouch. I can tell he's in bad shape. I'm thinking a car accident, more than a brawl. And before I know it, part of my life has been wheeled away to be barcoded, refrigerated, then drawn into another body where it will flood muscles and remember how to cruise in its favorite commute. The U-turn at fingertip. The tug back to the heart. Repeat. Repeat. Hands off, the man yells. I wasn't dragged into this hole to be infected. I walked in here to give away the most valuable thing I hold. To spread myself out so I'd walk the street and wonder if part of me was with the girl on the bench with Angel inked across her shoulders. Or maybe the man straddling the avenue, swinging his cane like he's going to hit the next cab out of the park. But for all I know, my blood will pulse through this man's sour tongue. And for a moment, I want that bag of my life back. Then I recall how my blood isn't my own, how transfusion after transfusion at birth, I was delivered into embrasure, a mix of race and creed colliding in my cells. So now I want that crowd sluicing inside this man. I want transfer and mixture unending. Until, at least in ourselves, we won't be able to tell who's who until we're all gliding each other's veins. So there are a bunch of poems in this book. I think 8 poems that are in form that are about jazz musicians. So haikus, sonnets, villanelles, Miles Davis, Chet Baker, and some other guys. So I will think I'll read one of those. This is a sonnet ending with a line by Miles. I don't really do a very good Miles interpretation.
Don't.
I'm not going to try, right? Yeah. Okay, thanks. So train. Coltrane, right? Train, of course, could start with a phrase and keep shattering it until he'd been through every shuffled combination. Until, fracture upon fracture, he blew the phrase from every different angle. The run collapsing back into itself. The quick transit of his fingertips blurred by the sweep of those furious calisthenics. The man had truth to play, and the truth's culmination is hard, so he tended to carry on. When he asked his colleague Miles, Train was still a sideman, how to end a solo, Miles only laughed, took a swig, and rasped, "You take the damn horn out your mouth." True. No, no lie.
Huh?
Yeah. Yeah.
You take the damn horn out your mouth.
So this next one is about Sappho. I think that many people who are into poetry at least know that a lot of her fragments were found wrapping mummies in Egypt. And so you unwrap the mummy, you get portions of a Sappho poem, but of course a lot of the wrappings just disintegrated, right? So you get all these gaps and leaps, which make these poems that are 1,300 years old oddly modern. You know, you read these and they have these modern leaps, which are just so incredible. So this is called Sappho in Egypt. Mummified crocodiles, her shredded songs curved with the dry sticks of their tongues. Strip by torn strip, unknowing servants applied them to the mummy's solemn ribs. And what ancient paste could have saved them from sifting to trays of shriveled olives and pomegranate? Her songs restored thus, unraveled to vacancies, whole sections traded for an arid hush. Slender omissions erupting into strains of a nervous lover. My tongue breaks up and a delicate fire runs through my flesh. Her body ravaged by a need so deep, only this forged rhythm could keep her from breaking down, from seeing that the fires which rage inside us are a kind rehearsal for death. And how to edge closer to that mystery than such silence. Her town market preserved. Its teeming inventory, oyster, wine flask, figs, and golden bracelets. The punctured intervals erasing half her city, so the streets are lent a new, imposed syncopation. Ankle bone cups, honey, chickpeas. Each piece parceled and perfect, as if it were the first time sounds were used to signify the world. Crocodile, pomegranate, the words curving, still wet on my tongue. So I'm thinking, I like when people give a notice, like, right, I'm going to read one more poem, I'm going to read two more poems, and what was it? Now I always forget.
But one will be the Iliad.
That's right. So, who was it? You remember who was? Who was it? You remember? I saw a poet read one time, and it was so great. He was like, I'm going to read one last poem, the Iliad. I'm going to read two, and it won't be the Iliad and the Odyssey. And these are a little bit shorter. This is called Chicken. When I first moved to Vermont, I had lived in New York City for 10 years. My first couple books were all about New York City, and that was my subject matter. And when I came here, I was like, What am I doing? What am I going to do here? Anyway, so this is called Chicken. Now we do have chickens. Now Joanna and I have five awesome chickens, but that was not how we started off 10 years ago. Chicken. At the Harvest Festival, when we were celebrating with pumpkin tarts and cider, an older farmer asked what I was into. and maybe my answer was muffled a bit from the cider's tang, because he started talking passionately, not about his favorite poet or the use of weather in haiku, but about his chickens. White leghorns, silky bantams, Rhode Island reds, buff Orpingtons. How, in corporate agriculture, the birds are bred so big that their legs cripple beneath them, and isn't that a shame? I tried to break in to tell him he had misheard, but he shook his head and held up his finger. That's not the case with his birds. When his hens are laying, he puts oyster shells in their grit to give them extra calcium for their own shells. His birds are free-range, not de-beaked and stuffed 24 to a pen. Freedom makes all the difference in the world. You can taste their happiness, he said. Even see it. Their yolks a rich, almost tangerine color, not pale like those you get from the grocery. And he was starting to get out of breath from excitement. And by this time, to tell you the truth, I was just hoping he didn't ask about my birds. Because I don't know if I could have broken it to him. Poetry, I said, not poultry. And so this last one is the title poem, Bone Music. Again, there's this. Which I have to say real quick, I was lucky enough to get this cover image from a museum in Hungary. And I emailed them, I finally got a curator's name and I emailed them, got no response. A week later, I emailed them, no response. And then I was like, Steve Kramer, you're stupid. Email it in Hungarian. So I Google translated it into Hungarian, and the next day I had a response and got this pretty cover. So I'm pretty happy with that. All right. Inky aquariums, ghost windows. With vinyl scarce, we couldn't even bootleg songs until some back alley genius first scavenged dumpsters behind hospitals for this unlikely savior. The eddy and churn of snow, gravel under boot, and then among syringes and bandages, beneath battalions of rubber gloves and masks, this stashed blessing of discarded x-rays. Ah, to bring them home. These slides where bodies are reduced to sooty maps. A cobalt fog inscribed with knots of calcium, collagen streaks. We scissored each sheet into a circle and used the blooming end of a cigarette to burn a center hole. Then we pressed the contraband of Ellington, Armstrong, and Basie onto each until a trumpet's ragged helix shimmied on a broken femur. The cloud of a skull with its zipper of teeth. The stacked totem of a spine. When the state caught wind, slides grew scarce as Siberian mangoes, and we scrounged for our own CAT scans, ultrasounds. Aunt Sophia's MRI is a Coleman Hawkins, notes escaping like smoke from the cage of her ribs. Bring on winter, bring on disease and rot and fracture, because the more broken we become, the more music we can spin out of our bones. Thanks, guys.
Take your seat. You have to look at me.
Okay. You can move the podium wherever you want.
Oh, yeah. I can create my own boogie space here. Yeah. I'm happy with the boogie space that you created here. Well, thanks, everyone, for being here, and I'm really... pleased to be in your town and in this beautiful bookstore that I have loved for a very long time. It's an honor to read here, and so thanks, Bear Pond, for having us, and really honored to be reading with Stephen and Neil, poets that I admire greatly. I know that I mentioned this the last time I read here with Stephen, but he's actually, when he was editor of the Green Mountains Review, he was the first person ever to publish a poem of mine. So, and that was 20 years ago this spring, actually, and it was a while after that before I had another publication, so that sustained me through that lean time. And
Stephen was Neil.
What did it, oh yeah, no, that's sorry, Neil. That's it was right. Neil, yeah, not 20, yeah. We go back a long way too. But so anyway, I want to thank you for that first publication in a magazine that I loved, and And who knows where I'd be today if I hadn't. So I'm going to read some poems from this book that came out last year. And it's National Poetry Month, so I've been repeating myself a lot with these poems, which is fine, except that Karen McCadden is here, and I read with her recently, and she heard all of these same poems, so I might try to mix it up a little bit. Cliff didn't hear. Yeah, that's true. Well, if I'm brave, maybe I'll mix it up a little bit. If I can, I might chicken out trying to read something that I haven't practiced, but we'll see. So I'm going to start with a poem called Earthquake. When I tell you my childhood was wasted at sea, you should bear in mind I may be an unreliable narrator. When I say I spent a year in military school, disguised as a boy, be skeptical, though in fact I did. Each morning we polished our boots to an oily sheen and ran through the spruce woods with empty guns. When I tell you I love white wine, it's the plain truth, as is the fact that my mother was a painter and my father a cellist or a physicist. I get the two confused. I get confused about the relative weight of my loneliness. It seems so heavy, but where is it? Did you know I survived shipwreck, that I was marooned and lived a long time on the island? Surely that explains this hook-shaped scar, my love of salt. I ask for no help with these burdens. The earthquake rocked the building's foundation, and the bedposts swayed like masts. We set off from port. All my lies are like that. They travel so far over the horizon, then finally come back, my sea-weary, long-lost kin. Okay, going off script here a little bit. This is called Conception. Girl curled around your book, go outside to the tamaracks. Untie your shoes. Remember the story. On the night you were conceived, your mother dreamt of obedience, your milk teeth all buried beneath that tree. In the churchyards, brides and birds preen near white cake tasting like wax. He will undress you. Or you will row a frail boat to a harbor near ruined temples where honey is gathered. The sting on your heel is soothed by salve of the flower the bee sucked. Loosen your hair. It doesn't matter which you begin with. Either way, your words are sealed with burnt sugar. In the end, you will have to forgive yourself. This one's called Luxury. A letter arrived from Wales, and I never opened it. That's Wales the country, not Wales. I would love to get a letter from a whale, but Wales. A letter arrived from Wales, and I never opened it. That was my one luxury before the cherry blossoms opened in the park. It was the spring I had a broken heart and a neighbor who played green sleeves every night on her violin. I dyed my hair blue, then bluer. I think of Wales as a country of sailors and shepherds. My ancestors came from there long ago, and once I visited a castle on the edge of the Irish Sea. Very delicate cups of tea. The sheep were so shy on the hillsides, I think I am generalizing. I don't even know for sure that it was a letter. I thought of the bells and the pints of beer, the sailors. The envelope was thin and white as a petal, a blossom from a distant tree. My one luxury. It was enough. It was addressed to me. So I'll tell you a secret about this poem, which is I like it. I like this poem. But actually, I wrote it at a point where I was so sick of my poems that I was like, I'm just going to write a Karen Gottschall poem. Like, I'm just going to, like, write, like, like the most Karen Gottschall poem in the world, and it's going to have me dyeing my hair blue and a letter from Wales. Blah. So I wrote it, and then I showed it to some people, and they were like, this is great.
This attitude.
Yeah. And I've come to kind of like it. I don't know. This one's called More Lies. Sometimes I say I'm going to meet my sister at the cafe, even though I have no sister, just because it's such a beautiful thing to say. I've always thought so, ever since I read a novel in which two sisters were constantly meeting in cafes. Today, for example, I walked alone on the wet sidewalk, wearing my rain boots, expecting someone might ask where I was headed. I bought a steno pad and a watch battery, the store windows fogged up. Rain in April is a kind of promise, and it costs nothing. I carried a bag of books to the cafe and ordered tea. I like a place that's lit by lamps. I like a place where you can hear people talk about small things, like the difference between azure and cerulean, and the price of tulips. It's going down. I watched someone who could be my sister walk in, shaking the rain from her hair. I thought, even now, florists are filling their coolers with tulips, $5 a bundle. All over the city, there are sisters. Any one of them could be mine. Okay, this one's called Even 40, and I wrote it in response to a big birthday, which is a few years ago now, but Even 40. I'm still just a girl, just a donkey of sorts. I have this soft mouth. In the morning, for 2 full hours, I resemble my mother. I am a woman in space, a spacewalker. My first jewel was beveled plastic. I stand in the lamplight wearing a slip. It's winter and the raccoons are hibernating. Rose hips drum against the aluminum shed. They were sent into space, the satellites, and they died. Wink, wink, there's a blue light blinking above the clouds. I haven't got a string of pearls. No lovers, no magazines. I gave them away to the saints. This one's called Eros and the Reader, which it's a bookstore kind of poem. It's about books. The sad truth is, I have wanted to live inside a novel more than I have wanted to live inside my own life. This has been the case since the very first novel I read, which involved a love affair between a girl and a pig. That old story. Since then, a lifetime of stirring coffee with diner spoons, thinking this is so like something in a novel. A lifetime of moments too, nothing like those in books, eating sweet potatoes for dinner every night, letting the cat stand on the table. There was one summer I worked in a kitchen, sweating through my tank top. I was reading the Brontes and I grew very thin. Another summer, I was so in love, I could think of nothing except my nails on his skin, but he didn't want me, and I went back to reading Proust. I studied French because it's a language so frequently spoken in books. I bought myself a scarf that wound 12 times around my neck because a girl in a book I read had one. Then I let it hang loose, dragging at my feet, waiting for the hands that would carefully loop it under my chin. How many times have I practiced running on flagstones and sealing letters? I'm forever sealing letters, slowly stirring sugar into coffee, falling in love and buying apples. There are not enough swans around here, though. There are not enough heaths or swales. I lack for trains and painters, whiskey and Sunday mornings, horseshoes, hurricane lamps, cast iron pots, revolvers, and gentle, deft hands winding my scarf. This is kind of fun. Reading poems that I wasn't expecting to read. Let's see, what else? could go south really quickly, but this one's called, maybe I'll read a couple of sort of ghost story poems. This one's called Yellow House Poem. Leave unexcavated from the narrow strip of garden the matchbox cars, the Lego astronauts, the fingers of dolls. Unlistened to the zing of unplugged telephone static and no red windbreakers snag in the trees. Unpried the floorboards between whose sloping joints are collected nickels, stuck as though through a jukebox slot to needle the house's hits or release cool sugar. There's a memory in the basement, unpretty, seven-ish. She burns her clothes each evening in the furnace and is unreachable through Ouija. There's another in the master bedroom, pregnant wisp holding her belly. Leave undug the backyard, the base of the utility pole standing like a priest with a direct connection to the forces of electricity, tirades, and greenish skies. Leave unglassed the windows where rain leaks in and streaks the wall with exhaust. There is no crack in the stairs. The teeth of vacant winters have gnawed the burrows of historic mice, and slivers in the kitchen collect unswept. Meter readers, do not visit this street. No fat letters are dropped in the mail slot. No owl nests in the garage's dry rafters. No wisdom, no midnight who. There are no children here to soothe. Mm-hmm. Just a couple more from this book, and then I'll end with a couple of new poems. This one's called Ghost Story. At 2 a.m., the lamp came on by itself, and I sat in my t-shirt in the circle of yellow light, asking the spirit what it wanted. Leaves shifted in the gutter. How long have I lived in this house? Long enough to have worn out my boots, long enough to have used up the vinegar. I don't remember very much from our first autumn here, just the sound the wind made in the wall before we had it fixed. We all have to moan sometimes. We all need some attention. I made the spirit a promise. I said I would leave the lamp on. I said I would stay. At 3 a.m., the light clicked off again, just as I'd begun to drowse and dream about the characters from a book I thought I'd forgotten. I walked back to bed in the dark, the pads of my feet flat against the wooden floorboards. Two white hands floated before me in the blackness, and they scared me, even though I knew they were my own hands. The reason I say it could go south is, I mean, there are a lot of, like, sad poems in this book. And, like, I realize that when I start to, like, put a reading together, like, I'm trying not to just, like, depress the hell out of everybody. So, okay. This one's called, it's got a running title. So the title goes into the first line. Tell your phone to stop calling me from the bottom of the river. Tell midnight to stop coming in strange cities where the bells sound emptier and heavy. Tell Mary her hands are too open already. She may not have noticed there's no one to fill them. Your phone has debased itself, its pad of numbers, a set of little soft fingertips sealed in plastic, its contact list kicked downstream. I wished something once, I almost forget. It had to do with you. It had to do with the vowels of my name, blue water warm to sink into. It didn't work out that way. Tell the moon I admire it for conserving its energy. Tell the river if it wants to talk, there are certain courtesies. It should empty its mouth of stones. It should fall on its knees. So I'm giving away all my secrets tonight. This poem is actually about butt dialing. You know, like somebody calls you and like you just hear this like. So. That's what that's about. Okay, so now I'm going to end with two new poems. This is a two-poem warning. These are recent poems, still kind of in progress. They seem it's fun to finish with newer work. So this is called Tame. The feral cat I've tethered since September to a supply of fancy feast still has all her distrust intact. Who can blame her with nights this cold? As for me, I learned the alphabet like it was edible, and I've been hungry ever since. I am still not quite familiar with myself either, I guess. I get lost in the cemetery, looking for my ancestors, tripping on roots. What I've always liked about my family is the way no one ever says how they really feel, so it is possible to imagine anything. I make sure to tell the cat I love you so she will not have to become a poet like me. She moves like a girl who has never been burdened with her own reflection. I remember that I used to like my shoulders, and growing up it seemed like boys liked them too, but it has been a long time since I gave them much thought. It's a shame when the particulars of yourself start to disappear into the routine of days you didn't make and seem to have little stake in. These days, I tell my students, the point of discomfort is interesting to investigate, but I know that I am usually not that brave. I'm a house cat, really. I swore off heartbreak after the last one carved me up in the standard way. I told myself I'd die if I'm not tamed. I said, kitty, this is your bowl, your very own. Behind the house, the weeds are full of Greek mythology, and the last full moon kept me up for two nights straight. But the frost is coming. I creep closer and closer to the wood stove. Soon I will be all the way inside, docile to the point that anyone might put a match to me and be warmed by my burning for a long, long time. And finally, this is called Origin Story. Lake Michigan dreamed me, I think, in the winter of 1969, its long currents combing shipwrecks, and where was my mama then? She was wearing a red muumuu. And where was my father then? He was fishing for steelhead. No one dreamed you, stupid girl, the seagull said. You came straight from the belly of your granddad's school mascot. You wore plaid skirts and bruised your knees and lived across the street from the motorcycle shop. I remember dropping dimes in the jukebox. I remember embers in the sand. Once I saw God himself, a small boy running across the RV park with a toy sword in his hand. I dreamed we all lay down on the beach and the dunes moved over our bodies. It took 10,000 years of whispering, but we finally slept. And before that, the seagull asked. Before that, I found comfort in the fur of animals and the movement of a boat on the water. I was warm in my mother's arms. Before that, I was a sonic boom over Wisconsin. And before that, fire. Thank you.
Right.
Thanks to Bear Pond for having us.
Yes, thank you.
And maybe want to help them out by purchasing a few books.
We have books.
Stevens, Karen.
Yeah.
We have books we'll happily sell you. That's all we have for tonight. We'll be happy to sign any copies that you might have. That's it. Have a good rest of the evening.
Thanks.